Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. The first item of business today is the committee's consideration of the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill at Stage 2, which we started last week. We are resuming today and the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Shirley-Ann Somerville, joins us again for this item. So thank you for joining us. I will briefly explain the procedure we will be following during today's proceedings for anyone watching. Members should have with them a copy of the bill, the marshalled list and the groupings which were published on the 23rd of September. These documents are available on the bill webpage on the Scottish Parliament's website for anyone observing. I will call each amendment individually in the order of the marshalled list, and the member who lodged the amendment should either move it or say not moved when it is called. If that member doesn't move it, any other member present may do so. The groupings of amendments sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be debated. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. In each debate, I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in the group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. I will then call other members with amendments in the group to speak to, but not to move their amendments and to speak to other amendments in the group if they wish. I will then call any other members who wish to speak in the debate. Members wishing to speak should indicate that by catching my or the clerk's attention. I will then call the Cabinet Secretary if she has not already spoken in the debate. Finally, I will call the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up and to indicate whether he or she wishes to press the amendment or to withdraw it. If the amendment is pressed, I will put the question on the amendment. And if a member wishes to withdraw an amendment after it has been moved and debated, I will ask whether any member present objects. If there is an objection, I will immediately put the question on the amendment. Later amendments in a group are not debated again when they are reached. If they are moved, I will put the question on them straight away. If there is a division, only committee members are entitled to vote. Voting is by a show of hands, and it is important members keep their hands raised clearly until the clerk has recorded their names. As convener, I must exercise a casting vote in the event of a tie. And the committee is also required to consider and decide on each section and schedule of the bill and the long title. I will put the question on each of these provisions at the appropriate point. We will now move on to consideration of the amendments and start with the grouping named appointees and representatives. So I call Amendment 52 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 53, 54, 55, 56, 126, 9 and 102. And ask the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 52 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you and good morning, Convener. I move Amendment 52 and will speak to that and all the other members' amendments in the group. The Scottish Government's Amendments 52 and 53 are technical changes to clarify that an individual's eligibility to receive assistance has no bearing on whether an appointee may act on their behalf. An appointee may act in connection with a determination, even if the result of that determination is that the individual is not eligible. Amendments 54, 55 and 56 are minor terminology drafting amendments which change the word there and they are to the persons and the persons, the person is, respectively, avoiding any potential ambiguity as to who is being referred to. It has no substantive effect on the operation of the provision or policy. Amendment 102 corrects an error in the 2018 Act. My officials, while considering other amendments to the bill, identified that Section 85B5 of the 2018 Act on appointees is not included in the list of negative procedure powers in Section 96(3). Amendment 102 amends Section 24 of the bill to correct that. And I ask committee to support Amendments 52 through 56 and 102. Moving on to Amendment 126 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, which seeks to allow Scottish ministers to appoint a person who already has authority to act on behalf of a child, for example, someone with existing parental responsibilities and rights. I again thank Mr Balfour for his ongoing interest and support in ensuring we make payments to the right person and based on the best interests of disabled children. This is, I think, our shared aim, and I will explain why I do not think this amendment will meet that aim. I believe this amendment could create uncertainty or an unnecessary additional step for parents who in most cases already have the right to be their child's legal representative. Social Security Scotland already have existing procedures in place to ensure that payment of child disability payment goes to someone who is suitable to manage this on behalf of the child. Social Security Scotland will take action urgently where there is information received that suggests that persons may no longer be suitable. They will also ensure payments are suspended when there is a risk of financial abuse or someone is no longer able to continue managing the assistance. I'm concerned that this amendment may result in Social Security Scotland and the First Tier Tribunal being used as an arena for some separated parents to play out their disputes, with neither being suited to fully arbitrate such disputes. I believe this is a negative outcome for Social Security Scotland, the Tribunal and the child, particularly when there are existing processes in place to manage such disputes. I've written to Mr Balfour providing more information on this, and I hope he's had the opportunity to reflect on that additional information. For these reasons, the Government doesn't support Amendment 126, and I would ask Mr Balfour not to press. Finally, turning to Jeremy Balfour's Amendment 9, which seeks to put third-party representatives on a statutory footing by setting out existing policy and processes in primary legislation. Nomination of a third-party representative can already be achieved under existing common law using a mandate form, and the process has been in place at Social Security Scotland for over 4 years. Clients are not restricted to using Social Security Scotland's mandate. They can nominate a third-party representative using other methods, such as over the phone or by submitting an organisation's own mandate. I understand the motivation behind this amendment and can assure the committee that the Government is continuing to listen to clients and stakeholders and will seek to streamline the administrative process for nominating a third-party representative as much as possible. So, for example, for the launch of pension age disability payment, we have integrated a mandate into the application form, reducing the need for any additional forms or phone calls from the client. I'm not persuaded that we should be removing the flexibility to respond quickly to feedback and to continuously improve our processes by setting out such operational detail in primary legislation. And we've heard similar things from organisations who do regularly act as third-party representatives in connection with Social Security. Citizens Advice Scotland told us that it doesn't support Amendment 9. CAS said, and I quote, that the insertion of this process into legislation and the addition of the word must may create operational difficulties, noting that representatives can, of course, change in the course of a client journey. Therefore, while I very much respect the intent behind this amendment, I would encourage Mr Balfour again not to press. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour to speak to Amendment 126 and other amendments in the group.
Good morning to you, colleagues, Cabinet Secretary. To start with, would say that I am fully supportive of the Government amendments and will be voting for them. If I can go to Amendment 9, first of all, I think there has been some confusion around this from some of the feedback I've had from third sector organisations. I also think I'm slightly concerned that we are relying on practice notes, things that happen within Social Security Scotland, because those can change without any scrutiny by Parliament and by this committee. And I think on certain issues we do need to have it either in primary legislation or within regulations, so that if there are changes made by Social Security Scotland or if a different government comes in and changes practice, then we have at least some role in scrutinising that. What my Amendment 9 seeks to do, and again, there has been mixed feedback on how Social Security Scotland have dealt with these in the last 4 years, is that where I want to have the same representative all the way through, I am able to say that at the start. I'm able to say that I want all those individuals, that individual, to have the papers all the way through to the end of a first-tier tribunal, if it goes that far. I think that safeguards the individual. So, for example, you may have somebody who has early dementia or some other condition. You may have those that live in very chaotic households, and papers will come in and go out, and they won't often note when they have to be responded to. It seems to me, and I would be happy again if the Cabinet Secretary picks up, there seems to be a presumption that you have a six-month notice of representation, and then after that 6 months, you have to go back to Social Security Scotland and offer that individual to continue to do that. My fear is that if people forget that 6 months, then their representative no longer gets the papers, and the claim could then go off track. This doesn't stop the individual at any point saying, I don't want that person to represent me, but it puts that person in charge. I think that is the way forward, and I think it does give the claimant the assurance that the representative gets all the documentation that is required from Social Security Scotland. In regard to Amendment 126 for children, I do accept what the Cabinet Secretary says, but again, we're being asked as a Parliament to rely on Social Security Scotland acting in a certain way. I would be interested, and I have read the correspondence, and I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that, but I'm not absolutely sure what is the legal basis for Social Security Scotland being able to do all this. Who gives them the power to make these notices, to make all those things? Where was the legislation allowing them to do that? And I would be interested, if in her closing, if she could maybe just deal with that issue. At the moment, I am still minded to move my two amendments in regard to this, but I look forward to hearing what the Cabinet Secretary has to say in her closing. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. I'm going to invite any other members if they want to come in. And Paul Keane, thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I would start by saying that we are supportive of the Government's amendments in this section, and will support those. I think, turning very briefly to Mr Balfour's two amendments, I think I would recognise some of what the Cabinet Secretary said in her contribution, particularly on Amendment 126, in terms of, I think, the challenge in Mr Balfour's amendment in ensuring that there is flexibility in the system to appoint the right person to receive money on behalf of a child, and indeed not to, I suppose, interfere or challenge the established processes. And I do hear the Cabinet Secretary's concern that family court situations might then be played out within the social security system, and I do think we need to just be very careful, and I am reassured by what she has said about the processes and procedures that will be in place. On Amendment 9, in terms of those third parties being appointed, 126, I'm mixing up my amendment numbers, my apologies. So, supportive of 9. In terms of 126, I think I do have some concerns in terms of trying to understand exactly the views that have been expressed by the third sector, because there have been a variety of views. I think this debate has been helpful, but I think the clarity that Mr Balfour was looking for from the Cabinet Secretary, the further clarity, would be helpful to have prior to making our decision. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Paul. I don't know if anyone else would like to come in. No. I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I can just respond to some of the points made by Mr Balfour and Mr O'Kane on aspects around the authority of Social Security Scotland to make the decisions that they do in terms of children. That's based on the common law approach to their decision making. with regards to the other amendment, I can absolutely, again, as I said, and I think in my opening remarks, absolutely see where Mr Balfour's coming from on this around third-party representatives. I think this is one of the areas, though, where we have to be really careful about unintended consequences. So, for example, there is a default position that there is a 3 months aspect to representation, but that was asked for example, by the Scottish Women's Convention. So we can imagine circumstances where a woman who is having coercive control from her partner, husband, may wish not to have something like Mr Balfour's suggesting. So I think this is one of these areas where primary legislation really isn't the place, because it needs to be flexible. In saying that, of course, a client can ask for longer. It's the default position for 3 months, but it's not. It must be 3 months. And clients have that opportunity, as said in my opening remarks, not just to use the mandate form from Social Security Scotland, and not just to do the 3 months, but they can choose to do something different, should they so wish. Certainly.
It's okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm supportive of the position you're outlining, Cabinet Secretary, but also conscious Mr Balfour was suggesting a scenario where the individual wanted the representative to stay in place, but for whatever reason, the paperwork, the bureaucracy, the administration around refreshing that authorisation went askew somehow. For there could be a variety of reasons for that, and I think Mr Balfour, not speaking for Mr Balfour, I just want to get clarity from the Cabinet Secretary, was worried that could be an unintended consequence to withdraw that representative mandate. What safeguards would be in place under the government position, or is it more about culture and practice within the system rather than specific legislation on the face of the bill?
Well, it's not around, I would suggest, legislation on the face of the bill. As I say, it's important that we have an ability to be much more flexible than we can be in primary legislation on these issues. But there is, of course, strict guidance that is followed by Social Security Scotland. So, yes, there's the culture and the ethos, but more importantly, the guidance. And I would say on the concern around not having a scrutiny on this, obviously the committee can call the Chief Executive and others from Social Security Scotland to discuss anything that they wish, if there's areas of that are coming off from concern on it. And, of course, the Parliament has the power to ask SCOS to report on any matter relevant to Social Security if there is, again, an area of concern. So I think, while I absolutely recognise that, as I've said with many issues in Social Security Scotland, the agency is still new, the agency is learning, it's open to learning, it's open to adaptations. I think that is the way to do that, in conjunction with stakeholders, knowing that we have the ability either for Parliament or SCOS to scrutinise and to investigate should they wish to, and therefore I would still ask Mr Balfour not to press.
Okay, thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. I call Amendment 53 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 52. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And the question is that Section 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendments 54, 55 and 56, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 54 to 56 on block.
Moved on block.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 54 to 56?
No.
No.
The question is that Amendments 54 to 56 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 126 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 52. Jeremy Balfour to move. Not move.
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 126 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No. Okay. So we are not agreed. Therefore, there will be a division. Can I just ask those in favour of Amendment 126 to raise their hands? Two. Can I ask those against to raise their hands? Okay. Oh, body. Okay. So the result of the division on Amendment 126 is 4-2 and against. Six. That's 6. So as a result, the amendment is therefore disagreed to. So I call Amendment 9 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 52. Jeremy Balfour to move or not move?
No, move, convener.
The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. At this point, then, there's going to be a division held, and can I ask 4 to put your hands up? And for against? As the result is a tie, I must exercise a casting vote. My casting vote is against the amendment. The amendment is therefore disagreed to. Okay. I call Amendment 57 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendments 10, 58, 99 and 103. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 57 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, before I speak to the amendments within this grouping individually, it might be helpful I offer some context on the development of these provisions and the rationale that underpins them. I recognise some stakeholders and members have raised concerns about what is being proposed, and I hope to be able to address those concerns today. Firstly, let me be clear that the ethos of treating individuals with fairness, dignity and respect is the bedrock upon which our social security system is built. I'm content that nothing within this section of the bill runs contrary to that ethos. As a government minister, I have a duty to ensure I am stewarding public finances responsibly, and this is a duty I take very seriously. Value for money is also one of the fundamental social security principles in Section 1 of the 2018 Act. In its 2021-22 annual report, Audit Scotland considered it a matter of priority that the agency develops the capability to assess the levels of fraud and error present within their caseload. Ministers and accountable officers also have a duty under the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000 to understand the levels of fraud and error present within the devolved social security system. It is therefore crucial that the agency can produce robust estimates. When developing these provisions, we have sought to balance our ethos of fairness, dignity and respect with these duties and with the principle of value for money. I am content we've struck the right balance that protects individuals while protecting the public purse. I will speak to the non-government amendments first and then move to the government amendments in my name. Amendment 10 in Jeremy Balfour's name would remove the provisions from the bill that allow Scottish ministers to make a decision to suspend entitlement in cases where the agency has repeatedly and unsuccessfully tried to gather the necessary audit information. While I recognise the laudable aim of the amendment is to protect individuals from having their entitlement suspended unnecessarily as part of the audit process, I cannot support it. Where repeated attempts to obtain the required information have not been successful, the agency must be able to quickly establish that the individual remains entitled to the assistance and that significant overpayments are not being accrued. We may, for example, have to establish whether the individual is still residing in Scotland and thereby meets the necessary residency criteria. Following detailed consideration of options, suspension has been identified as the most effective tool to ensure that people participate in the audit process. I hope the committee will recognise it is a proportionate intervention where, as we clearly intend, it is applied in line with our ethos of treating people with that dignity, fairness and respect. While this is a new suspension power, it should be borne in mind by the committee that the powers are entirely consistent with Scottish ministers' existing powers to suspend assistance where they require information to make a determination of entitlement. If somebody stops responding to Social Security Scotland, that rightly raises a concern. The existing suspension powers are in place so that people and the public purse can both be protected. Removing the suspension powers from this part of the bill would not therefore prevent this possibility of suspension altogether. It would simply undermine the whole point of taking the powers in the first place. Those existing powers, however, can only be used in situations where ministers require information to decide whether or not someone is still entitled to assistance. For example, where somebody had stopped responding to Social Security's correspondence, they could not be used to request information to inform a statistical sample. This is one reason why the additional suspension powers at Part 6 are required, and the other reason being we consider it more transparent to place the relevant powers alongside the relevant part of the primary legislation. I'd like to reiterate that suspending payments is not a decision to be taken lightly and will only ever be done when extensive and repeated efforts have been made by the agency to gather the necessary information for the audit process. I hope it will further reassure the committee that safeguards are also built into the process. Individuals will have the right to ask Scottish ministers to review their decision to suspend their assistance, and any suspended assistance will be backdated if they subsequently respond to the request for information. The Scottish Government cannot therefore support Amendment 10. Turning now to the Amendment 58 in Maggie Chapman's name, which would remove the provisions in relation to information fraud in their entirety. And I think I can also deal here with Amendments 99 and 103, which I understand are simply consequential. My officials undertook a detailed options appraisal on how to provide an audit framework and considered best practice in other parts of the UK and other countries for gathering such information. This informed the development of these provisions. If Amendment 58 were to succeed, the agency would be left with no powers to require information from individuals. The agency would only be able to gather information from individuals who opted to participate in the audit process. This self-selection of participants is likely to mean that those who know they should have reported a change of circumstances and did not do so, and those who know they are claiming on false pretences would simply not participate. It would also be inconsistent with similar mandatory client survey approaches conducted in other countries, including the rest of the UK, Ireland, Canada and Australia. Amendment 58 would damage the validity of any data gathered and prevent the agency from responding effectively to Audit Scotland's recommendation. It would arguably cut across ministers' duties under the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act to accurately assess the levels of fraud and error within the caseload. However, I recognise that stakeholders may still have concerns in this area, and I want to reassure the committee that my officials will work to address them, including through public consultation. We have included safeguards within the process to ensure that individuals will be supported to participate with the right to an advocate or supporter. And as ever, we will continue to engage and work with stakeholders as this bill progresses and any subsequent legislation is developed. Turning now to Amendment 57 in my name, I committed to bring this amendment forward at stage one, and I would urge the committee to support. It will place a duty on Scottish ministers to undertake a public consultation on the categories of individuals who should be exempt from the participation in the information for audit process. While it would not be appropriate to prejudge the results of that, or indeed any future consultation, or to definitively list types of individuals who would be exempt from providing information, it may help if I offer an example of one category who could be included within the regulations. Initial policy discussions suggested that those whose entitlement had recently been reviewed would automatically be exempt from participation, and we would of course welcome stakeholder views on other categories of people who should be exempted from the exercise. I'm hopeful that Amendment 57 further illustrates our commitment to work with stakeholders and to address any concerns they have. Convener, as I've outlined, these provisions seek to balance two different sets of priorities, and as the committee noted in its Stage 1 report, this is not an easy thing to achieve. But as a government minister, I have a duty to ensure that the public purse is protected and that funds are spent wisely and appropriately. But that cannot come at a cost of departing from our principles and ethos of treating people with dignity, fairness and respect. I am content that we've struck the correct balance in the provisions within the bill. It is not feasible, for the reasons outlined above, for the agency not to undertake audit activity to assess the levels of fraud and error within their caseload. But I'm also aware that some stakeholders have concerns about what is proposed, and I hope the measures and safeguards that we've outlined will help ease some of those concerns. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Would you like to move the amendment?
I move the amendment.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour to speak to Amendment 10 and other amendments in the group. Thank you, Convener.
I think it would probably be fair to say, of all the areas that we looked at Stage 1, this was probably the one that was the most controversial and perhaps the hardest for us to come to a view on. And in some ways, it's unfortunate that Mr Mason is no longer with us, as he was a bit of a Rottweiler on this particular issue. So I think I would, with your permission, Convener, just take a wee bit of time to explain where I'm coming from in regard to this. Let me be absolutely clear. I believe in audit, and that's why I think at this moment of time I won't be supporting Maggie Chapman's to get rid of the audit completely, although I look forward to her trying to persuade me otherwise. But I do believe in audit, but it's who are we auditing? And the point of the audit, as was set out in the original purpose of the bill, was to audit Social Security Scotland. And if I can give an example, this is, I feel, we've taken a step further than that. And what we're saying now is we want to actually audit people who have been given an entitlement to an award that has not changed. Nothing in the circumstances have changed, but we're now going to take that away. So we've moved quite cleverly, I would argue, by the Scottish Government from saying we want to audit Social Security Scotland by going through a back door and saying, actually, this is all about fraud, nothing to do with how Social Security Scotland is doing. Absolutely.
Okay. I hear where Mr Balfour's coming from. Could he perhaps try and persuade me that you can audit Social Security Scotland and the way that they do things without auditing the decisions that they make and therefore their caseload? I simply don't see, because the entire purpose of Social Security Scotland is to deliver the right decisions at the right time. Therefore, you must examine the decisions.
You just took the words right out of my mouth. So here's my persuasive argument for your secretary, for Cabinet Secretary, is can you imagine the RBS, Bank of Scotland, any other of these big banks being audited? They are audited on an annual basis, and rightly so. But could you imagine them coming to say, well, look, we actually want to audit how you're managing your account as an individual accountant, and if you don't give us that information, we'll close down your bank account? Because that is actually what we're doing here. We're saying we're going beyond auditing the organisation. We're actually now looking at regard to the people who are benefiting from that. And that doesn't seem to me what audit is. Now, I think there should be a power for Social Security Scotland to go to a claimant and say, would you give us that information? Would you share that information with us? But if they, for whatever reason, don't want to do that, I don't think they should be penalised. And if I can develop this further, Section 52 of the 2018 Act allows for unscheduled review of entitlement. So, in fact, Social Security Scotland can go already to anybody and ask them to review. They have that power already. What they don't have that power is to take away an award without then doing that review. And I think that is a very significant difference. The Law Society, in their submission to us, said this conflates audit and fraud. And they say it is not clear why individuals should need to be involved in auditing the system in this way, or indeed why ministers could not obtain the information they need through other channels. And for once, I agree with the Law Society of Scotland. I think they are absolutely right. We are trying to use audit as a way of bringing about fraud claims. And with due respect to the government, I do think we've stepped over the line between treating a claimant with dignity, fairness and respect. And goes beyond that, we are now introducing whatever terminology you want to use, we are now using sanctions to stop somebody. Now, we have had debates about sanctions for a long time. Marie McNair has said benefit sanctions are a vehicle for penalising those who are in need of benefits. Ben McPherson, a former previous Minister for Social Security, said, "We have shown that people respond much better to support and encouragement than do the threat and fear." But if we support, as the bill stands at the moment, we as a committee are voting for sanctions, because we are voting to say to somebody, just because you will not give Social Security some kind of response, we will take away your benefit and we'll hold your benefit back. Now, you might get it back later on, but that doesn't help you in that immediate period. That seems to me not to be teaching people with dignity, fairness and respect, because that individual has done nothing wrong. The circumstances haven't changed. The claim that they were entitled to is still the same. All they are saying is, we do not want to be involved in this audit process. And I think that that seems to me unfair. I'm interested that, again, in the Scottish Government response to our report at stage one, we do seem to move from audit to fraudulent, where the Cabinet Secretary said, if there is no such power to suspend sanction, there is no incentive for anyone who is claiming assistance fraudulently to participate in the process. Well, that is true, but the point is, the Scottish Government already have that power to do that under Section 52 of the 2018 Act. But what they want to add to this is the power to sanction someone without reviewing their claim. And I just believe that goes too far. So I am not arguing against audit of Social Security Scotland, and I think that's where I probably do disagree with Maggie Chapman. But what I'm totally against is auditing individuals, vulnerable individuals, in regard to the decisions that they have no power over. On the presumption that I may not be successful in the next few minutes, I will support Section 57 of the Scottish Government, because I think at least it gives organisations and individuals a further bite at the cherry. But I would generally urge members to think about what they are voting for here, and are they going too far in regard to getting information from vulnerable individuals who have, I repeat, done nothing wrong, the circumstances haven't changed, all they have been unwilling to do is respond to an audit which is meant to be auditing an organisation, not an individual. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. I'm now going to invite Maggie Chapman to speak to Amendment 58 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Can I begin by thanking the Cabinet Secretary for the conversations we've had about this bill in the run-up to Stage 2. I'm speaking to my amendments 58, 99 and 103, the substantive one being 58. And can I say at the outset that I do believe in audit, I just don't think that this is the right... as it's set out, the section is appropriate at this time. Section 16 gives powers to Social Security Scotland to request information from random individuals receiving payments in order to ascertain levels of error by the recipient and fraud in the system. It follows an Audit Scotland annual report which recommended that something needed to be done on this. Some categories of people can be made exempt by later regulations, and individuals who have a good reason not to respond, for example, because of recent bereavement, can ask for the request to be withdrawn or postponed, but it will not necessarily be granted. If people don't give the information requested, their payments can be suspended until they do, and ultimately a new determination made, which could mean their payments are stopped altogether. This section wasn't included in the public consultation, and stakeholders, including CPAG, SAMH, Citizens Advice, Law Society, RNIB and others, are concerned about its effects, and I'll come on to the reasons in a moment. The Cabinet Secretary has suggested that she will work with them to produce guidance, but the only government amendment dealing with this section is to add public consultation on the exempt categories, not on the broader powers within the section. So there are five key concerns with this section, and the first is that lack of public consultation. The public consultation on most of the bill ran in 2022. The audit report that the Cabinet Secretary and I have referred to was published in 2023. So that audit report that suggested something needed to be done to provide for an audit capacity didn't come till after the public consultation on the bill. So I think given the very wide concerns raised by stakeholders, both about the lack of consultation and the substantive provisions, I think I have serious concerns whether this section is the right section at this time. I think there is the possibility that we leave ourselves open to hostages to fortune and to unintended consequences. The second concern is around the question whether this information from individuals is needed in the way that the section outlines. Erica Young of Citizens Advice pointed out that rates, even of suspected fraud, are very low, and there are already adequate audit procedures to estimate official error. Several witnesses suggested that estimates of user-led error or fraud could be obtained by other means, looking at evidence from determinations, redeterminations and appeals, and CPAG and Alliance have both outlined these processes quite clearly. So the audit report only said that we needed to continue to develop processes in this space, not necessarily require immediate and such far-reaching action as the section outlines. The third reason is the question or concern around the need for punitive sanctions, and Jeremy Balfour has already outlined significant concerns in this area. The bill includes provision for suspension of payments and redetermination if information is not provided, and many stakeholders find this disproportionate and deeply concerning. It has the potential to raise issues like stigma, practical difficulties in compliance from vulnerable groups, from people exposed to trauma and mistrust because of previous experiences with the DWP, for instance. And then there are questions around hardship caused by suspension of benefits, unfairness about suspension when no suspicion of actual fraud is evident. I do appreciate the provisions, including categories of people not required to give this information, and the Cabinet Secretary's Stage 2 amendment on public consultation on this, but not everyone who will suffer from this will fall into clear, permanent or documented categories. The Cabinet Secretary argues that without sanctions, the system will be ineffective, but I don't think this is necessarily so. If people are determined on deliberate fraud, then they may be able to obtain exemptions anyway. We also have said that some people, the sample of those asked to provide evidence would be random, and it would not be random if people could self-select. But arguably it's not random anyway if some categories of people are exempt, which of course they should be. Claire Andrews from RNIB suggested, I think, a sensible suggestion. Introduce something initially, but without suspensions, without sanctions, on a test and learn basis. And I would ask the Cabinet Secretary in her summing up to outline why this wasn't an approach taken. The fourth reason is that separation of functions, which Jeremy Balfour has already talked about, the conflation between an audit process and fraud investigation. There are comments in the explanatory notes for this legislation that those two systems must be kept separate, but there is they cannot be held separate if the information provided by an individual could perhaps incriminate them because of how they have provided that information. And as Jeremy Balfour outlines, the Law Society said there would be quite clear need to give caution and information about the rights to people asked to provide this information in case they could incriminate themselves. And the final reason for objection to this section is the compatibility with principles point. Many stakeholders raised quite fundamental questions about how the operation of Section 16 would work in comparison with other social security processes, including in this bill. John Shaw notes that even its language is different in style to other sections. So I would argue that the section as it stands is not proportionate and may not be, as Michael Clancy suggests, may not be compatible with our human rights obligations. I do understand the need for some audit functions, for audit to ensure the due diligence that the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, the duty to steward public funds effectively and to ensure value for money in our public services. But this section, I think, blurs that line and takes it too far, and the lack of public consultation on the whole operation of the section gives me cause for concern. So I would ask committee members please to support this amendment, and just on other amendments in this group, I would be, if I had a vote today, I would be supportive of Jeremy Balfour's amendments and the Cabinet Secretary's amendment. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks, Maggie. Before I invite any other members in to speak, can I just remind members to try and be as concise as possible and where possible not repeat themselves, and I understand you're obviously wanting to get your point across. So with that, I'm going to invite other members to come in, and I believe Bob Doris would like to come in. Thank you.
No pressure then, Convener, in relation to being concise. I appreciate that. A proactive chastisement of my remarks. I believe that Jeremy Balfour makes incredibly well-intentioned and important arguments. I genuinely think, sincerely think, your solutions, or Mr. Balfour's solutions, are weak. I would make a similar point about Maggie Chapman's amendment also. I'll reflect on that during my contribution. I think to suggest that, as Mr. Balfour appears to do, that the audit process should be entirely voluntary would mean it would not be systematic and it would not be methodical. And I think that would be a real key weakness in meeting the Audit Scotland key recommendations that they made a few years ago. So that puts, I think, the legislation at a disadvantage if we were to pass Mr. Balfour's amendments. I'd be suggesting we don't do that. Yes, of course.
Are you comfortable with somebody who's been awarded a benefit, whose circumstances haven't changed, to be sanctioned simply because they're not returning a piece of paper to Social Security Scotland? Are you comfortable with that? Do you think that treats people with fairness, dignity and respect?
I think what I say to Mr. Balfour is I'm going to come on to that later in my contribution, and I would refute the way that Mr. Balfour's also framed the question to me, and I'll say more about that a little bit later. I think if we were to take Mr. Balfour's advice, we'd have the best audit in the world for Social Security Scotland. I think we would find that fraud was, and I accept it will be very low level at the moment, I think we'd find it almost completely non-existent if we take Mr. Balfour's advice, and the error was almost non-existent as well on the basis of a self-selecting audit means those that are likely to step forward to be audited in the first place are those who are absolutely not likely to have an overpayment or there to be any fraudulent activity at all. So I think we'd have the best audit process in the world in terms of finding that Social Security Scotland was doing a fantastic job. I'm sure they are doing a very good job, but we have to identify where there are weaknesses, and a self-selecting audit would not allow us to identify those weaknesses. So I think okay, Mr. Balfour.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy Convener. Again, reflecting on this, does the Social Security Scotland under Section 52 already have that power? Why do we need an additional power?
I would suggest to Mr. Balfour, and I'm happy to take more interventions from him, but if he just waits a wee bit, I'm coming on to all of that during my contribution anyway. So I think the audit would lack credibility if we pass these amendments today. Now, I think it is weak to say that a backstop would be there's a power already under the unscheduled review of circumstances. If Audit Scotland was to use that power for audit purposes, it would actually feel as if they're targeting the individuals who, by using that power, because that is there where they where Social Security Scotland thinks there may be a change of circumstances, or there may be fraudulent activity, or there may be an overpayment. So to use that power is almost to indicate that there's something amiss, whereas a random, statistically significant, structured, strategic and methodical audit means that no one has been targeted. But to use the backstop power that Mr Balfour suggests would be to target individuals, in my view. I would like to know a bit more information from the Cabinet Secretary ahead of Stage 3, or perhaps at Stage 3, more details of the exemptions that will be consulted upon, but also for the threshold, a bit more clarity in the threshold where payments will be suspended, because I think Mr Balfour does have some strong points around that one of the reasons that someone may not be supplying that information is a clear vulnerability. So it's the threshold by which Social Security Scotland then moves to suspend a benefit. Will they get a welfare check knock at their door, for example, Mr Balfour? I'm just bringing to where the risk assessment and the risk profile will be before a move to suspend would be taken. So I think it is important that we do get more information on that, but that doesn't mean that I concede that, as well intentioned as Mr Balfour or Ms Chapman's amendments are, that I'm minded that they should be done. Finally, perhaps her son or the Cabinet Secretary could say a little bit more about, once this audit process is embedded within Social Security Scotland, how they will review that themselves to improve it, to finesse it. And again, just to say that I believe that it's an absolute last resort to suspend payments. So it's getting that threshold right, and it's putting welfare first over suspension of benefits first. And I think there's a balance to be struck there, which I genuinely think is like Mr Balfour and Ms Chapman is trying to explore today, but I don't think these amendments secure that.
Okay. Thank you, Deputy Convener. Would any other member like to come in? I'm going to invite Kevin Stewart.
The words, as always, dignity, fairness and respect have come into play today. And as the person who first got those three words into legislation as an amendment to the Scottish Welfare Fund Bill, I recognise how important those three words are. I also recognise that we shouldn't pay lip service to them and ensure that dignity, fairness and respect is at the very heart of all that we do. I do want to hear from the Cabinet Secretary in her summing up about certain aspects of this, because there have been various things said this morning, but I recognise that the Cabinet Secretary, the government, has a duty to steward public funds appropriately. And I do have concerns around about scenarios where people could ignore requests for information, which in itself would cause some real difficulties in terms of audit, because the amendments put forward by Mr Balfour and Ms Chapman could mean that there would be an inability to produce robust fraud and error estimates, which I think others would want to know as we move forward and as part of an audit process. So I would like to hear more from the Cabinet Secretary around about some of the other commentary where, you know, it has been said that there are adequate procedures to deal with fraud. I'd also like to hear from the Cabinet Secretary around about the exemptions, because I think that is extremely important. Overall, I would like to know from the Cabinet Secretary how else could the government actually come up with robust fraud and error estimates, which I think everybody would require the government to do, if these amendments from Mr Balfour and Ms Chapman were to be passed today. Thank you, Convener.
OK, thank you, Kevin. I'm now going to invite Paul O'Kanan.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and I think the contributions of colleagues have been helpful in terms of this debate. And I think, as Mr Balfour and others have alluded to, this was a contentious section and probably arguably the most contentious section of the bill that we took evidence on from stakeholders. It's those stakeholders that I think I'm keen to put at the forefront of our consideration this morning. Of course, I recognise and understand the principle of desiring information for audit. It's important for understanding how Social Security as a system operates, its impact, its inefficiencies and efficiencies, and the support that it gives rightly to people, but also to identify where there might be issues of fraud and error, and particularly issues of fraud which can have a criminal element to them. And I think we should all be concerned by that. And I think it's for that reason that I wouldn't support removing this section entirely, because I do think there is important work in this space, and I wouldn't therefore support Maggie Chapman's approach to removing the entire section from the bill. But I think what I would recognise in Mr Balfour's amendment is, I think, the concerns that have been raised that this amendment, I think, is challenging, and perhaps we could do further work in terms of consultation with those stakeholders that I spoke about to understand how a system might work more efficiently. Indeed, there are opportunities, I think, to look at regulation and co-designing regulation that actually might have more input in terms of, rather than something that's on the face of the bill. Yes, I'll give way to Mr Doris.
I appreciate Mr Kane giving way, and I'm appreciative of the balanced approach that Mr Kane's taken in relation to considering these amendments. Whatever the committee in Parliament ultimately decides, Mr Kane agree that if someone does not supply back information, it doesn't necessarily mean there's been overpayment. It doesn't necessarily mean there's been any fraud. It could mean there's a vulnerability there, which is the reason why they haven't got back to Social Security Scotland. And if we do proceed with the suspension of payments, and I think we should do, Mr O'Kane, we have to be very clear about the threshold and the welfare checks around when suspension may actually ultimately kick in.
So I would absolutely recognise what Mr Doris says there and what he outlined in his contribution, and I think it is helpful to the point that I suppose I'm trying to make, which is actually within this section, I would like to see further work on perhaps a statutory footing for some of the measures that Mr Doris talks about, and it's where I think actually Mr Balfour removing this section by amendment and not, I suppose, replacing it with something, there is an opportunity then at the further stage of this bill to have a consideration of what we might do to put some of those things on a statutory footing. I think that's why it's important that, and I'm putting that on the record this morning, because I think there is an opportunity to look, and I know the Cabinet Secretary will want to talk about some of this, I'm sure, in her closing contribution, but perhaps for us to think about how we put different requirements, different forms of consequence, different forms of support on that statutory footing. And I think that's why I have sympathy with Mr Balfour taking this section out, so that we can return to it at stage three. So I think the convener was asking for brevity. I could go on, and I will leave it there. I'm very grateful.
OK, thank you, Paul. I'm now going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Much, Convener, and can I thank members for all their thoughts on this, and I again put on record that I very much appreciate where the amendments from Jeremy Balfour and Maggie Chapman are coming from on their concerns. What I would say is that clearly a government has met with stakeholders since stage one on this process, particularly because of the evidence that was given to committee on that, and they were specifically asked if amendments should be brought forward, and no stakeholder asked the government to bring forward amendments on this. And I believe that there are ways that we can continue to reassure those stakeholders about safeguarding without the amendments that are being proposed today. Convener, I go back to the point that I made to Mr Balfour. I simply cannot see a way where you can audit Social Security Scotland without examining the caseload and therefore asking for the information from this. Everyone on the committee does agree that there does need to be audit there. This is about how we do the audit and how we do an audit that is robust. And again, I simply cannot see how we can have a robust audit if it is a self-selecting process. You will have an audit, it will not be robust. Maggie Chapman is quite right to point out the fact that benefit fraud is low. We know benefit fraud is low because there's been an audit, and that's the purpose of audit, is actually to reassure us and to ensure that those who may wish to use misinformation about the level of benefit fraud or to attack people who come forward for benefits, it allows us to have the evidence to say that this is not a major issue in our area of benefits. But it is something which clearly exists and where it is we must take seriously. Certainly.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary. I mean, I do have sympathy with what the Cabinet Secretary is saying. I suppose my concern is still around the sanctions that come to the individual if they don't respond to this. Now, I know you're trying to address that in Amendment 57, but I wonder, to try to seek some kind of consensus, would there be any possibility, picking up Mr Dorris's point, that before Stage 3, we could have a fuller list of who wouldn't be sanctioned if they didn't respond, actually in the bill? So is there opportunity for government to outline at least some categories of individuals? You may want to add to that after the consultation, but actually in the face of the bill to say, if you are category X, Y or Z, you won't be sanctioned if you don't respond to this.
If Mr Balfour will allow, I'll take that away and reflect on it, but what I would say is that I think it was Maggie Chapman had raised that there needs to be more consultation on this, and the whole point of not putting this on the face of the bill was to allow that public consultation to take place. So I can see where he's coming from, but I'm a little bit hesitant only because I've actually said and committed that we would have a consultation on this that obviously people would be able to take part in. But I'll reflect to see if there's more.
Will the Cabinet Secretary also reflect on the fact that if those exemptions are on the face of the bill, then that makes it much more difficult to add those exemptions in the future? Will you reflect on that point as well, please, Cabinet Secretary?
I certainly will, and Mr Stewart's quite right to point out the pros and cons putting again something on primary legislation. I would absolutely want to put on the record as well that under this government, there will never be sanctions in Social Security. Never. And the reason why is because they're ineffective. They are absolutely ineffective, as well as being immoral. So there will never be a sanction. But we do have to have a robust system. And if I can give an example of why this actually may be to the benefit of the client. If we begin a process and there then receives information where actually there's been a massive overpayment building up. For example, to a vulnerable client, the last thing you would want to do is allow that overpayment to continue to build up for even more time, because at some point that overpayment would have to be paid back. So there are reasons as well to the benefit of a client where it may be advantageous to ensure that the information is provided. Mr Balfour, I think, places a lot of weight on the fact we don't need this power because we've got other powers within the previous Act. I would very simply just have to disagree with him on that. Section 52 allows for determinations without application as set out in regulations, but can only be done if considering to make a determination, e.g. a change of circumstances and overpayment. This is different. This is different, and therefore the powers that Mr Balfour suggests are in 52 would not assist us in this process. But what it does point to is we already have suspension powers that are very carefully used within the social security system. A number of members have quite rightly, convener, talked about safeguarding, and I think that is absolutely critical for what we're doing, because again I think we're all coming from the same point on this. The safeguards that are in the bill as already drafted is that individuals have a right to request withdrawal of information requests and a right to support for response to Social Security Scotland. Safeguards that are already in the 2018 Act are also there. And I think Mr O'Kane raises a really important point. And again, I'll need to reflect on what could be done between stage two and three and what should be on the face of a bill. But he is quite right to point out that when the agency is moving forward with this type of guidance, it's very important that that's done in conjunction with stakeholders. Now, I would say that's the way it's always done. That's the way fraud and error in itself was done when it was first introduced. It's the way that guidance is always done by the agency. They do not sit there unilaterally. There is very much that openness and an openness to learn and adapt. And I think that is very important that while we're still working through what that operational process will look like, the stakeholders will absolutely have an opportunity to get involved in the development of that process. But if I can reassure committee on certain aspects that the process will be designed to be as sympathetic as possible to circumstances while maintaining statistical rigour. Individuals selected will have access to support. There will be scope for people to provide the required information in a range of formats. Reasonable timescales will also always be in place to gather that information. People can ask to have a request withdrawn if they think they've got good reason. Suspension and determination without application will only ever take place when people have had received numerous reminders and timeframes. And I absolutely, again, appreciate the fact that people want to make sure that that's done not just in letters, not just in a way that may not be useful to a vulnerable client, but that's done in a way that is sympathetic to vulnerabilities. And again, that's something which stakeholders and the agency need to work together on. So, for the sake of near brevity, convener, I'll end my remarks there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And before I move on, can I just say, just after this, before we move on to Section 17, we're going to have a comfort break. Okay, just to make you aware. So the question is that Amendment 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 10 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 57. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Move, convener.
Okay. Next one. Question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed, so there will be a division. Can I ask for those in favour to raise their hands? Those against? Okay, so as a result, there is a tie and I must exercise a casting vote. My casting vote is against the amendment. The amendment, therefore, is disagreed. Okay. I call Amendment 58 in the name of Maggie Chapman, already debated with Amendment 57. Maggie Chapman, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Okay. We are not agreed. There will be a division.
Dividing Amendment 58.
Yeah, it's to do with Amendment 58. So, I'll repeat it again. The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Okay, so we're not agreed, so there will be a division. Can I ask for those who are in favour of Amendment 58? Okay. So it's the result of that is a zero. Sorry. Can I ask for those against? My apologies. Is there any abstentions?
Okay, it's just still disagreed to.
Okay. So as a result of that, it has been disagreed to. Thank you. So the question is that we don't need that one. Sorry. My apologies there for a procedural mix-up. I can just confirm that we're going to have a small comfort break and look forward to seeing you back in about 5 minutes. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. I am going to call Amendment 59 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. So I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 59 and speak to all amendments in the group.
We agreed to Section 16 before the break.
We don't need to.
Okay.
But thanks for reminding me, Kevin. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. The Government has proposed amendments in my name that fall under three themes for the compensation recovery provision, stylistic drafting changes, changes to improve clarity, and some small changes to the proposed powers in the relevant parts of the Bill. Firstly, Amendments 61, 62, 63, 68, 75, 79, 82, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90 and 91 all make stylistic changes to the drafting provisions. The majority of these amendments are designed to address the overuse of the word any in the provisions by replacing it with the words a or an where appropriate. Others are designed to remove duplication or to make grammatical changes. We consider these to be minor and to have no effect on the operation of the provisions. Moving on, the committee will note that the compensation recovery provisions are complex. The next set of amendments are designed to provide clarity and simplify where possible without impacting the functionality of the provision. A key issue is that the provisions must make reference to multiple parties, often within the same section, and this can be confusing. Section 94A in particular refers to many different parties, so Amendments 59 and 60 help clarify to whom the specific provisions apply. Section 94M of the Bill provides for the reviews of certificates of recoverable assistance. On reconsideration, we identified that we could reduce complexity here through Amendments 69, 70, 71 and 72 by making a small change to the wording, updating the references and eliminating the need for subsection 6. Following engagement with bodies representing the insurance industry, we believe that we can reduce complexity in Section 94H when referring to policies of insurance via Amendments 66 and 67. These changes ensure that the meaning is clearer without having any impact on how the provision will function in alignment with the rest of the UK. Also within this section, we intend that a policy of insurance should only cover liability so far as that policy has been stated to cover and not any more. The Association of British Insurers in particular expressed concern that this was not clear enough in the Bill, and Amendment 64 removes the risk that this could be misinterpreted to read that the insurer covers all liability beyond the terms of policy. There may be situations where, following a reconsideration or appeal, it has been revealed that a person who received compensation payment has knowingly provided inaccurate or insufficient information, and we believe that also proving that person's intention to increase the compensation payment is not necessary here, as there could be no other reason to do it, and Amendment 77 removes that requirement in Section 94P. Amendments 78, 80 and 81 apply to the provisions for periodical payments. On review, we were concerned that these could be confusing. The amendments remove words that add no value to the provisions, simplifying this section, and will have no impact on the effect. The next series of amendments are designed to make some changes to the powers proposed when the Bill was first introduced. Many of these changes were in response to scrutiny from both the Delegated Powers and Law Reform and Social Justice and Social Security Committees. At Section 94H, we agreed with the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee that the equivalent UK provision contains a more restricted power to limit the amount of the insurer's liability. We agreed that a wider power was not required, and Amendment 65 makes this change. Amendment 84 relates to the diffuse mesothelioma payment scheme administrator. As drafted, the provision could apply to anyone providing any services to the DMPS administrator. However, we do not intend for this to apply so broadly. The amendment narrows this power to apply only to those specifically acting on behalf of the administrator. Amendments 73, 74 and 76 relate to the provisions for appeals against a certificate of recoverable assistance at the first tier tribunal. They remove unnecessary subsections relating to raising an appeal. It is more appropriate that these should be covered in tribunal rules. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee also queried the regulation-making power relating to the non-disclosure of medical advice or evidence given in connection with an appeal. On review, it was identified that a power contained in the tribunal rules, already in practice, makes sufficient provision in relation to the disclosure of documents and information, and as such, Amendment 76 removes this unnecessary power. Amendments 100 and 101 remove the references to these powers from the section outlining procedures. Section 94T provides regulation-making powers for the provision of information in relation to recovery from compensation payments. It was also identified that this may apply more broadly than necessary, deviating from the equivalent provision in the UK legislation. Amendment 85 narrows this power. There is also no need to specify mandatory content for regulations, so Amendment 83 makes changes to allow for content that could be included within regulations, and I hope everyone has followed those technical amendments. Convener.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary done very well.
And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite members in, and I believe Jeremy Balfour would like to come in.
Yeah, thank you, Gradually, I won't be speaking for long. I think the overwhelming majority of these amendments we are supporting. We cannot support 73, 74 and 76. The reason for that, and again, I think it comes just down to a different view in regard to legislation. I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary said, but these are already in the tribunal rules and regulations. Again, I come back to the point, these are not scrutinised by Parliament. If they happen to change one day, we could see a very different system working, and there would be no way that the Parliament, out with calling in the clearly could call in the Chamber President, but has no power to keep these amended. I believe they should stay within primary legislation, and then the tribunal rules should follow and flow from that, rather than the other way round. So I can't support those three, but all the others I absolutely agree with.
Okay, would any other member like to come in? Bob, thank you.
I just wanted to make a general point, Convener. I was going to say, could you just say that again, Cabinet Secretary? I didn't quite catch it, but I won't. But what is clearly self-evident, and it's really just to put on the record, the legislation team from government has clearly went through the legislation with a fine-tooth comb to tighten up and to clarify matters. And in years to come, whoever sitting at committee will welcome that clarification, but it's clearly a lot of work from the officials. That is their job, of course, but we really welcome the work they've put in relation to this section. So I wanted to put that on the record.
Would any other member like to come in? Okay, thank you. I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up. Thank you.
Thanks, Kavir. Can I thank Mr Doris for his kind remarks to my officials. I absolutely would concur that the job they do on this and indeed other aspects is remarkable. So thank you for putting that on the record. With respect to Mr Balfour's points, I'm afraid, Mr Balfour, this is going to be one of those areas where we've had many discussions about tribunals over the years, and we have a disagreement about the best way to do this. I see where he's coming from, but I think I made the points I wish to make during my opening remarks around the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee's queries on this area and the reasons we took those decisions. So I'll perhaps, given the length of my opening remarks, Convener, leave it there.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question is that Amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendments 60. I'm going to break it up, given the comments that have been. So, call amendments 60 to 72, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move amendments 60 to 71 on block.
Moved on block.
Okay. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendment 60 to 71?
72.
Sorry, 72. My apologies.
No objections.
Okay. Okay. The question is that amendments 60 to 72 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I now call amendments 73.
Just call 73.
All in the name of the Minister and all previously debated.
Just call this one individually. Just call 73.
Uh-huh. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move amendment 73?
Moved.
The question is that amendments 73 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Okay. We are not agreed, so there will be a division. So can I ask members to raise their hands if they are in favour? Okay. Those against? The result of the division on the amendment is 6-4 and 2 against. Mm-hmm. The amendment is therefore agreed to.
Okay.
I call amendment 74, all in the name of the Minister.
Just calling on its own.
Okay, I'm just calling it on its own. So I invite the Minister to move amendment 74.
Moved.
Okay. Does any member... The question is that amendments 74 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Call amendments 75. Are all in the name of the Minister. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move?
Moved.
Okay.
Question 75 only.
The question is that amendment 75 is agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I call amendment 76 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. I ask the Cabinet Secretary
moved.
To move. Thank you. The question is that amendment 76 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I'm now going to call amendment 78 to 91.
Cabinet Secretary to move on.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move?
Sorry, 77, my apologies. Call 77.
I'll repeat that. Thanks very much for keeping me right. Okay, so I'm going to call amendments 77.
Uh-huh.
Moved.
Okay, thank you.
Questions.
And the question is that amendments 77 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? So I'm now going to call amendments 78 to 91. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move on block?
Moved on block.
Okay.
Any objection?
Can I ask any member if they object to a single question being put on amendments 78 to 91?
No.
Okay, thank you. And so the question is that amendments 78 to 91 are agreed to?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I got there with that big one. The question is that section 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I now call amendment 92 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with amendments 93, 94, 95, 96, 11 and 97. I'm going to ask the Cabinet Secretary to move amendment 92 and to speak to all the amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and I move amendment 92. Amendment 92, 93 and 94 bring regulation making powers in the bill relating to care experience, assistance, appointees, assistance given an error and information for audit within the scope of SCOSI's formal scrutiny remit. The bill at introduction sought to implement the findings of the Glenshura review and bring specific additional regulations into SCOSI's formal scope. At that point, the regulations being brought into scope did not include those for care experience assistance, compensation recovery, information for audit, appointees or assistance given error, as these were not under consideration at the time of the review. As the committee heard during stage one, there were calls from stakeholders for all of the new regulating powers in the bill to be subject to formal scrutiny by SCOS. Following that evidence, the Board of SCOS then wrote to me in April 2024, noting that they welcomed additional scrutiny of some of the regulations rather than all of the regulations made possible by the Bill. Amendments 92 to 94 in my name therefore add to the existing list of regulation-making powers captured under Section 97 of the 2018 Act in accordance with those exchanges with the Board of SCOS. Excuse me, Camilla. Clearly allergic to stage twos after a certain amount of time. And I would urge the committee to support them. We've seen how SCOS scrutiny adds value to the development of regulations, and I have no doubt that its scrutiny will similarly make an important contribution here. Amendments 95 and 96 simply ensure that Section 97 of the 2018 Act on formal scrutiny by SCOS applies to regulations whether they are subject to affirmative or negative procedure. Amendment 97 ensures SCOS is aligned with similar public bodies in its duties to publish an annual report. The review noted that the relatively onerous 2018 Act statutory duty on the Commission to prepare accounts and submit these for external audit should be removed. That requirement is being replaced by Amendment 97 with a more proportionate requirement to prepare an annual report, which is submitted to ministers and lodged in the Parliament. The SCOS Board have also welcomed this amendment. Turning now to Amendment 11 in Jeremy Balfour's name, which would expand SCOS' scrutiny to primary social security legislation as well as a broader range of secondary legislation, the Government cannot support this amendment. The Scottish Government is already bringing the majority of the regulation powers in the 2018 Act within the scope of scrutiny by SCOS, and this aligns with the recommendations of the independent review, which recommended focus on areas that can have an impact on clients. The widening of the scope proposed in Amendment 11 would both undercut this policy objective and create unclear resource implications for SCOS. The Government also has concerns about how the provisions on scrutiny of primary legislation would work in some contexts. For example, if emergency legislation is required, there might not be sufficient time. It's also important in this context to highlight that the functions of SCOS in the 2018 Act are already wide-ranging and not just related to the scrutiny of legislative proposals. SCOS can prepare and submit to Scottish ministers and Parliament advice on any matter relevant to social security when requested and report on whether expectations as set out in the Social Security Charter are being fulfilled, as well as any recommendations for improvement. I note in its most recent annual report that the Commission has progressed work in this area, and I believe it would be useful for this committee to consider these existing functions rather than creating entirely new statutory functions when the ones available to Parliament have been used so little. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour to speak to Amendment 11 and other amendments in the group. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome the Government amendment. I wonder whether, when the Minister's closure in regard to Amendment 97, she could confirm that no other bodies similar to SCOS have to provide public accounts that have been audited, and that would be a duty that would take them further and beyond others. Convener, I'll be honest, when we were putting through the original 2000 Act, myself and the Deputy Convener, I was a bit of a sceptic in regard to the Scottish Commission on Social Security. It felt to me like it was just going to be another talking shop, another body, which wasn't going to play a particular positive role in regard to the Scottish landscape. However, I am a sinner who has confessed and now have turned 180 degrees on that. And I welcome the work of SCOS in regard to what they do. I think they are a really important tool on the landscape. I think they pick up some of the gaps that we as a committee don't have time to do, and they bring in expertise to the process that we as a committee sometimes don't have either. And so I would actually seek to give them greater power in regard to the work that they do. This would be for them to decide. It wouldn't be for us or for Scottish Government to instruct that. I was struck by what the Cabinet Secretary said in her comments around these amendments, is that Scots can do this when requested. So we have to do it because it's been requested, either by Scottish Government or, I think, possibly by this committee. But I would like Scots to make that decision in regard to what they should look at. This also gives them greater power, I think, to look at acts that have been passed, to look at post-legislative scrutiny, which I think there's a general view across this Parliament that we are not very good at doing. I do accept that this may come with extra resources required to them, but we need to make sure that what we are passing, either as primary or as secondary legislation, is the best that it can be. And I believe that the Scottish Commission on Social Security do play a really important role in this. And I think to give them greater powers, again, future-proofing this bill for future years, future generations, is an opportunity that we shouldn't pass by. And so I would ask the committee to look favourably on my Amendment 11 and support it. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. And I'm sure the Commissioner very much welcome your comments today. So thank you. So I believe that Paul O'Kane would like to come in.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just to make a brief contribution, if I may. In terms of Amendments 95 and 96, in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, I did hear what she said, and I have read the purposes and explanations that have been provided in terms of it being an approach to sort of tidy up issues within the bill, although I do think I would share concerns that have been raised around perhaps Scots feeling that their power is weakened somewhat, and I think we just have to guard against that. So I would be keen for the Cabinet Secretary perhaps to just reflect on that if she can in her summing up, particularly around issues around, I suppose, the powers and the duties that I think Mr Balfour was referencing as well. And I actually think his points in his amendment about increasing the powers of scrutiny are very important. So, ahead of our consideration at stage three, we may wish to reserve judgment on a number of these items again, but I'm just keen to put that on the record and try and get some clarity.
Okay, thank you, Paul. I'm now going to invite Bob Dorison. Thank you.
It was lovely to hear that Jeremy Balfour is regretful of his previous views on Scots. I didn't hear him repent, but nonetheless. I just wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary, perhaps in her summing up, whether or not there's the need at some point in the future for a more consolidated strategic review of the powers and effectiveness of Scots, and whether it might not be the place of this bill to tack something on to increase the powers of the Commission, but rather as a Parliament at some point in the future, including this committee, could take evidence sessions on this, Mr Balfour, to decide what we feel the appropriate powers and roles of Scots could look like, and the government could respond to that, or the government could do something more proactive. I'm just not sure if this bill is the piece of legislation to do that bit of work. But that's all, Convener.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. Would any other member like to come in? No. Okay. I'm now going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Can I also, as I have the opportunity, thank SCOS, both its current and previous members, for their work. They have genuinely added value with every single piece of work that they've done since coming into existence, and I very much appreciate the work that they do. They have added value, and they have made social security better in Scotland. I think they can be exceptionally proud of the role that they've played in that. I can give the confirmation that Mr Balfour seeks around the accounts which he asked for, and also to point out that the review which was undertaken was also about streamlining. So in essence, it did much of what Mr Doris was suggesting. Obviously, it is for the committee to decide whether there's more they wish to do, but certainly the view was very wide-ranging, and it was about powers, and it was also to ensure that that SCOS in its structures and responsibilities was fit for purpose. So there was a streamlining element to that too, and hopefully that gives some reassurance to Mr O'Kane on this, because in essence I'm very keen that SCOS is strengthened. What I would say around Jeremy Balfour's amendment, SCOS has not asked for an amendment like this. I have not had an approach from SCOS to say that they would wish the implications of Mr Balfour's amendment to come to fruition, but I'm happy to go away between stage two and stage three to further clarify that with the chair. But the asks which were made of me in the letter, I've responded to with the amendments that are on in front of committee for discussion today. So I will again ask Mr Balfour on that basis not to press.
Okay. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. The question is that Amendment 92 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 93 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 92, and invite the Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 93 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And I call Amendment 94 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 92, and ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 94 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes. Yes.
Call Amendment 95 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 92. And ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 95 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 96 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 92. And ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 96 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I now call Amendment 11 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 92, and I ask Jeremy Balfour to move or not move.
Thank you. In the light of the Cabinet Secretary's contribution, I will reflect further and I will not move Amendment 11.
The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Oh, sorry. The question is that Sections 19 and 20, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I now call Amendment 97 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 92, and ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 97 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And moving on to Section 21, I call Amendment 12 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, grouped with Amendment 13. And I ask Jeremy Balfour to move Amendment 12 and speak to both amendments in the group. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, I should have said at the start of the meeting, as I said in the previous meeting, that I am in receipt of PIP and hope to be transferred to ADP at some point. And I'm also a former first-year tribunal member. Convener, in the distant past, me and the Deputy Convener had a pleasant day out at Victoria Quay about 8 or 9 years ago. And we were taken down there and we had a really interesting presentation of how the whole social security system was going to work, the input by Scottish Government, how this was going to be all singing, all dancing system. And it really was quite an interesting day out that we had, along with other members of the committee at that point. And I came away from that thinking this is going to be a system that we will be able to look at and say how well are they doing and how comparatively different is it to that of the DWP system. I have to say now, X number of years on from that, I think we haven't yet got that right. And there is a lot of information that we would like to know from Social Security Scotland in regard to how we are doing. So, for example, I wrote to them recently, and in the response they said, we are currently unable to measure or report on the time taken between the receipt of all supported information and the decision being made in a case. Now, that seems to me quite fundamental for us as a committee, if we're really going to scrutinise how well Social Security Scotland are doing, to see how are they meeting those. And that's why I'm seeking under Amendment 12 to bring in KPIs for Social Security Scotland. I do think not all of the fault here lies with Social Security Scotland, and on the presumption that the Cabinet Secretary wasn't in post at that time, either with her. But it was Scottish Government that designed the system that Social Security Scotland are using, and yet this system is not able to provide some very basic information. And so we cannot judge how well, on certain criteria, Social Security Scotland are doing. My amendment seeks to bring in KPIs for Social Security Scotland. Having listened on many occasions to the Cabinet Secretary, I appreciate it maybe it's not appropriate to have it in primary legislation. And so what I look to do is for the Scottish Government to go away, to consult, as they do very well, with this committee, with stakeholders and with other interest parties, and to bring back KPIs, which we can then measure how Social Security Scotland is doing. That seems to me a reasonable thing to happen, and it also allows us to be able to go forward with greater assurance. Now, clearly there is going to be information missing, because that is not there at the moment, and that is always going to be disappointing. But I do think we can rectify the situation to some degree. The same arguments I would use in regard to the work of the first-tier tribunal. I will come on to this more in the next section, if I can. But I do think we as a committee, we as a parliament, do need to have confidence that what we set as policy and principles is actually happening in practice. And my fear, again, is that that is not happening on a day-to-day basis. Again, in regard to the first-tier tribunal, I acknowledge that we don't want to put that necessarily into primary legislation. So, again, it seeks for government to go forward and think about this and bring forward appropriate secondary legislation. We all want Social Security Scotland to work, not just as a principle, but we want it to work because it is there to serve some of the most vulnerable in our society. If we can't know if they're doing that, then we are failing as a committee. And I think these KPIs coming forward could make a massive difference in regard to that. So I move Amendment 12 in my name.
OK, thank you, Jeremy. I'm going to invite other members if they would like to come in and comment. No? I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to come in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Mr Balfour's Amendments 12 and 13 would take a power to set out key performance indicators and legislation for both Social Security Scotland and for the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland. The Scottish Government does not support either amendment. As an executive agency, Social Security Scotland already publishes an annual report and accounts in line with the Scottish Public Finance Manual. It must comply with the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The 2018 Act also requires Scottish ministers to report on the number of people appealing to the tribunal. The committee can and frequently does hear evidence from senior leadership at Social Security Scotland on matters of operational delivery. The committee will also be aware that Section 15 of the 2018 Act requires a Scottish Social Security Charter to be prepared, published and reviewed, and the Charter was co-designed with people with lived experience of Social Security, and it underpins everything that the agency does. Approved by the Parliament in 2019, it sets out the service that people should expect from Social Security Scotland, and a revised charter developed using a comprehensive co-design approach with clients and stakeholders was approved by the Parliament in June. Convener, I would repeat my comments from the debate on the last group that if the committee would like more information on an aspect, the Parliament already has the power to get that section. Certainly.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner, that information is simply not available. I've given one example where I've written to Social Security Scotland to ask for that information, and they're not producing it. So we can have the Chief Executive in as often as we want, but if they're not producing that information, how can we scrutinise it?
I absolutely take that point. If Mr Balfour will bear with me, I will get to that, I assure him. But the committee does have that power to request information. In addition to allowing Scottish ministers to set key performance indicators for the first-tier tribunal, would undermine ministers' statutory duty to uphold the independence of tribunals, which itself bolsters guarantees of judicial independence enshrined elsewhere in legislation. This is a fundamental principle of democratic society. And like Social Security Scotland, the performance and operation of the first-tier tribunal is already subject to scrutiny. Now, if I can come back to the point that Mr Balfour has raised, I would, and Mr Balfour and I have had discussions on this, except there has been a degree of frustration over some parts of the information which he and others, stakeholders, have wished to see, and the fact that the management information is not there for Social Security to Scotland to pull, and to pull quickly. I also remember the trips down to Victoria Quay. I think I probably was responsible for Social Security at that time, Mr Balfour, given I have been for over half of his existence in devolution. And what he will remember also from those points, that this was an agile programme, that the aspects that were brought in were always going to be requiring continuous updating and improvements. That was part of the process and was clear from the start. Some of that is around the ability to obtain information and to request that information in an easy way that doesn't, for example, require a lot of manual workaround. So I hear and appreciate Mr Balfour's frustration in this issue. As he has already alluded to, I don't think the way to do that is through primary legislation, but I have offered to meet with Mr Balfour along with the senior management of the agency to discuss the areas where he feels that there is more information required, and that would clearly be something which we will continue to do with stakeholders as well. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour to wind up press or withdraw Amendment 12, and I would really very much appreciate brevity on this. Thank you.
As always, Convener. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her remarks. I mean, I still, I'm afraid, don't agree that this information is coming forward quick enough. I think there is a frustration that we don't know some of the timescales that are involved in the process. And I do welcome the meeting that has been arranged, as she mentioned a moment ago. I think a number of this committee and previous have been very critical of DWP in regard to the way of its processes. But I think, to be fair to DWP, at least their processes were there to be scrutinised. I have to say, I still don't think Social Security Scotland has been properly scrutinised, because we simply don't have that information. And I think KPIs are a way forward, which can be flexible, because they are in secondary legislation. And on that basis, I will press Amendment 12.
OK, thank you. The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
OK, we're not agreed. So there will be a division. So can I ask that those in favour of Amendment 12 to raise their hands. Okay, 4-4. Those against? 4. Okay, as a result of the 4-4 and 4 against, there's a tie. So I must exercise a casting vote. My casting vote is against the amendment. The amendment is therefore disagreed to. Thank you. I call Amendment 13 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 12. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
Not moved.
We'll move,
sorry, my apologies. So the question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Okay. We are not agreed, so there will be a division. Can I then ask those in favour of Amendment 13 to raise their hands? Four. Those against? Four. As a result, there is a tie and I must exercise my casting vote. My casting vote is against the amendment. The amendment is therefore disagreed to. So I call Amendment 14 in the name of Jeremy Balfour in a group on its own. Jeremy Balfour to move and speak to Amendment 14. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. You'll be pleased to hear, I think this is my last contribution of the morning. So can I take this opportunity also to thank the Cabinet Secretary's officials and herself for the positive engagement. We may disagree, but at least we disagree nicely. And I am also thankful for the officials for the time that they've given me, both one-to-one and in writing, in regard to this. Convener, this amendment, I think, seeks to bring about the principles that we all agree on, which is dignity, fairness and respect. Tribunals, the first tier tribunal, is an important place where people's cases can be looked at by a fresh pair of eyes and different decisions are made. We know statistically that the people that go to first tier tribunals are more likely to succeed and the appeals to be successful. For some people, the thought of going to an in-person tribunal is not what they want, and that should be absolutely respected. Whether they would prefer to have that online or whether they'd prefer to have simply a paper case from a tribunal to review it on paper should be their choice. But there should also be the choice that people should be allowed to go to a first-tier tribunal on a face-to-face basis if that is what they want. And that has changed since COVID, Convener. 8 years ago, 9 years ago, as I said before, I was a previous member of the DWP First Tier Tribunal, but still run by the Scottish Tribunals and Courts. Across the country, from Aberdeen to Stornoway to Gala to Dumfries, tribunals would be sitting on a daily basis, particularly in the Central Belt, and cases would be being heard. We discovered through an FOI that between January 23 and January 24, there had been one person hearing was held. 343 were heard by telephone in that same period. Now, I am sure all members spend their evenings reading the Scottish Tribunal's annual report 2022-23. But interestingly, within that report, there's a really interesting sentence, and this is why I brought Amendment 14 forward. It says in the Scottish Tribunal's annual report, in case shown, the Chamber President can, and I underline, can authorise an in-person hearing. That means the Chamber President has the choice of whether an in-person tribunal is held or not held. That does not mean that the individual will automatically be given an in-person tribunal if he or she wants it. And that is why this amendment, I think, is really important. I have heard from different organisations who do first-tier tribunals that they would want first-tier tribunals to be had in person. That's what the claimant has wanted, but they have been put off by the tribunal service in regard to that. For that reason, I think there should be a presumption of a first-tier tribunal. But if the claimant doesn't want that, whether they want a telephone or an online or a paper case, that is absolutely their choice. But for the Chamber President to have such a power to authorise it seems to me to move away from treating the individual with dignity, fairness and respect. And so I move Amendment 14 in my name.
Thank you, Jeremy. I'm going to invite any other members who wish to come in. Okay, no other members wishing to come in, so I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you.
Thank you, convener. The government doesn't support the amendment 14 from Jeremy Balfour, although I do acknowledge the points that he refers to, that some people in person, some people may wish an in-person hearing. I also very much agree that it is important for clients to have this choice. I appreciate that the SCTS gave evidence to committee in April, and they advised that the Chamber started operations during COVID where telephone hearings were the default, and that some of the users enjoyed and appreciated that format. They advised that where appellants want a certain type of hearing, the Tribunal will accommodate their choice unless there is a compelling reason not to do so, convener. My understanding from the committee session earlier this year when they gave evidence is that they are also making improvements to this service to allow people to choose what type of hearing best suits them, including in-person hearings, and to allow the people to express their preference through various channels. I understand that the number of in-person hearings, although still small in comparison to pre-pandemic levels, is increasing. Therefore, I do not think it's necessary to introduce a presumption in legislation if there's already a process in place to allow clients to choose. And I would also very much encourage the committee to consider that some people find a phone or a video hearing much less daunting than an in-person hearing, or they may find it more convenient in terms of fitting in with their day-to-day responsibilities and commitments. And I do fear that a presumption for an in-person hearing will have unintended consequences in effect pushing people towards a type of hearing that they do not actually wish and does not best suit their needs. The only other point I would make, convener, is I would have to refer back to the record, but I do think that the figures that Mr Balfour referred to were for the appeals that were due under the DWP system and not Social Security Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 14.
I will be pressing, Mr Convener. The Cabinet Secretary and I don't disagree. I totally accept that for some people, online or telephone is the way forward. And this in no way takes that away. And I don't accept the comment that this will have unforeseen circumstances. I do think we have to look at the evidence of what is happening on the ground. We do have to look at what is reported in the annual report, with the Chamber President having that power. And I do believe that actually for many people, and again the many third party organisations have given this to me, they do want to go along. And I have to say, from a purely practical experience, often when I was sitting on a tribunal, when the claimant walked in, you saw them face to face, immediately you understood why they were making the claim, and their decision was far more likely to go for them than if it had been on a telephone. So I actually do think...
I would hasten to add, if the case was that obvious, Mr Balfour, that points to a clear problem with the DWP process, that it forced that client to go to an appeal. And I would strongly suggest that evidence and experiences such as those that were gathered during DWP, that is not the way that our system operates. And I would simply refute that we would have cases where the way that an individual walked into a room would be how a tribunal should make a decision about something. It cannot be as clear as that, or something's gone far wrong with the initial decision.
Well, Camino, with due respect to the Cabinet Secretary, we don't know, because we're not having any in-person tribunals here in Scotland. And we also did make, debated this point previously, that often when the former DWP, now Social Security Scotland, when the person who'd gone to the tribunal looks at the case afresh, they can often come to a different view in regard to that, as can the tribunal.
Make sure that we can try and be, you know, as concise as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. Mr Balfour, the policy in terms of this amendment seems to be the presumption of face-to-face rather than the presumption of choice. But your argument, Mr Balfour, seems to be is that you'd wish the presumption of choice rather than perhaps face-to-face. So I'm concerned that your policy intent does not match an amendment.
Well, you know, my policy says it should be face-to-face unless the claimant doesn't want it. So that puts the choice right at the heart of what the claimant wants. So that is why I'm making this amendment. And what we are seeing, the evidence on paper and the evidence in practice, is that the Scottish Tribunal Service aren't doing this. And that's why I think we do need the amendment. I don't think it has any unforeseen consequences. I think it actually brings back and enforces dignity, fairness and respect, which this committee seems to be this morning deciding that we no longer believe in. Thank you.
Okay, the question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Can I then ask those in favour of Amendment 14 to raise their hands? Okay, we have four for Amendment 14. Those against? Okay, so four against. As a result, as there is a tie, I must exercise a casting vote. My casting vote is against the amendment. Amendment 14 is therefore disagreed to. Thank you. Question is that sections 22 and 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Call Amendment 98 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 25. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 98 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes. Call Amendment 99 in the name of Maggie Chapman. Already debated with Amendment 57. Maggie Chapman to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. Okay. The question is that, I'm going to call amendments 100, 101 and 102, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move amendments 100 to 102 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question being put on amendments 100 to 102? Okay. The question is that amendments 100 to 102 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call amendment 103 in the name of Maggie Chapman, already debated with amendment 57. Maggie Chapman to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay. The question is that section 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I now call Amendment 104 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to Amendment 104.
I move the amendment in my name, and the committee will be pleased to know that this is a minor amendment with a small speaking note to suggest that the bill requires this minor amendment because it will allow the provision setting out the parliamentary procedure for the regulating making powers to commence the day after the bill is given royal assent. It removes the need for a set of commencement regulations to be laid for section 24, which would be disproportionate given that the provision relates solely to parliamentary procedure. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Do any other members wish to come in? Okay, I ask the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
Nothing to add.
Okay, thank you. The question is that Amendment 104 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. The question is that section 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that section 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. That ends stage two consideration of the bill. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and her team for joining us this morning. And amendments for stage three can now be lodged with the legislation team clerks. So thank you all very much. And this concludes our public business for today. Oh, and before I conclude the business, I believe Ros McCall would like to come in, who's joining us remotely. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Convener. My apologies for doing this at the end. I had a rural internet hiccup at the worst possible time when we were voting on Amendment 58 just before the break. I've been trying to come in since. Very basically, I was put down as not voted due to that internet connection, but I'd like to go on record to say that I would have voted against that amendment. So just to go on record there, and apologies for the lack of internet support. Thank you.
Thank you, Ros, and that will be noted on record. Thank you. So now I conclude our public business for today. We will now move into private to consider the remaining item on the agenda. Thank you.